For those of you who don't know me, I'm Justin Anderson. I'm Dartmouth's Vice President for Communications. In a past life, I was a political reporter at ABC News. I didn't tell you that when you agreed to do this, so the questions might be a little bit more challenging than what I sent you in advance. So, presiding over events like this one are a special treat, and I love it when my worlds collide, and I can combine my love of politics and policy for my enthusiasm for sharing knowledge with students and really showcasing how special Dartmouth can be. And events like this with the congressmen are truly part of what makes Dartmouth special. And frankly, what makes New Hampshire special, particularly at this time of the year every 4 years. You know, there's a non-trivial chance that, you know, the next president of the United States will come to Dartmouth's campus and will attend events like this. And that's really special and it's really exciting. It's a long tradition that Dartmouth has of bringing candidates to campus. And candidates come and they allow the students, the community to take their measure. And that's a special thing that we have here. And every 4 years we get ridiculously excited for events like this. And this being the first one, we're looking forward to what will follow. So I'm gonna introduce the congressman more formally. He's gonna make some remarks. Then I will come back on stage and I will ask him some questions, and then there will be some time after our questions for you all to ask questions. So fear not, you will definitely have a chance to have at the congressman. So, Congressman and presidential candidate Will Hurd launched his campaign for the Republican presidential nomination on June 22nd, 2023, and we are eager to hear about his platform. Congressman Hurd grew up in San Antonio, where before we started, he told me it was 108 degrees just a couple of days ago. He served as a clandestine officer in the CIA from 2000 to 2009, including operations in Afghanistan, Pakistan, and India, and briefing members of Congress. Following work at a consulting firm and a cybersecurity firm, the congressman ran for and served in Congress from 2015 to 2021 as representative for Texas' 23rd district. During his time in Congress, he was praised for bipartisanship. He focused much of his work on technology and on national security. He did not run for re-election in 2020, instead returning to the private sector. Congressman Hurd has focused his campaign on responsible technology and artificial intelligence, and what he calls a common sense vision for America. Thank you for joining us, Congressman. Please join me in welcoming Congressman Will Hurd.
Thank you, Justin. Can y'all hear me in the back? Great. Well, the great weather today was brought to you for Will Hurd for America. And so you can send a thank you email. No, I'm joking. It's wonderful to be here.
What I was going to do today
is potentially try to set the tone for when other folks come, right? And oftentimes, I get frustrated with politics because we talk too much about politics, not enough about policy. And to be at such an august policy center, I think we should start this off. And for me, it's special being here because of my time in AI. I know the role Dartmouth has played in artificial intelligence. 1956, was that 69 years ago, 67 years ago? John McCarthy, one of your professors, was the first to use the phrase artificial intelligence here at Dartmouth Hall. I've been told, hopefully, go get a picture of that. And so what I want to do is talk to y'all about four or five policy initiatives that we should be doing in order to take advantage of AI before it takes advantage of us. And to have some context, I'm going to give you all a little bit about my background, go a little bit deeper on that. You know, I got an opportunity to have an internship at the Southwest Research Institute.
This was a place, it's the biggest private research institution in the United States. It's based in San Antonio, Texas. Why I got an internship there, I don't know, because the only skill I had at that time is I could type 60 words a minute. And I got to work for a woman who was running the robotics program. And I said, I want to be just like her. And she had gone to Stanford, I wanted to go to Stanford. She was a computer science major, I wanted to be a computer science major. And got into computer science in high school, and then my life was changed because I ended up going to Texas A&M instead of Stanford. I went to A&M, I got accepted to Stanford. I went to A&M because I had an Aggie that was a counselor of mine and said, you should try to go. I said, will you leave me alone if I actually go to campus for a couple of days? And he said, yes, so I went and I fell in love. And my freshman year, I'm walking across campus, I'm studying computer science, and I see a sign to say to take two journalism classes in Mexico for $425. I had $450 in my bank account, so I go to Mexico. Fell in love being in another culture. I was thought it was cool reading things I only read about in books. Look, I was born and raised in San Antonio. Never really went outside of San Antonio. And for me, this was an amazing experience. I had international studies as a minor, and I had this former CIA tough guy tell the most amazing stories. And I was like, I want to do that. And so when I graduated from A&M, I went into the CIA. My job was to recruit spies and steal secrets. Best job on the planet. I used to say I did 2 years at the super secret CIA training facility called The Farm. Now it's on Google Maps. I wish that was a joke. It really is on Google Maps. I did 2 years in India, 2 years in Pakistan, 2 years in New York City doing interagency work, and then a year and a half in Afghanistan where I managed all of our undercover operations. And let me take an aside here, since we are at a university. Do y'all know who my best officers were when I was in the CIA? Can you have a guess? Anyone? If I was in Texas, people would be like, the Texans, right? You know, that's not the case. It was my female officers. And I tell that to all the young women that are here in this crowd. You know, you hear a lot about James Bond, but Jennifer Bond is way cooler than James Bond. And I just put that out there as a potential pathway for y'all to potentially serve your country, do some exciting things. But one of the other things I had to do when I was in Congress, when I was in the CIA, was brief members of Congress. And let me be frank, I was pretty shocked by the caliber of our elected officials. That's me being polite. If I'm being honest, they were morons. And I thought they were countering some of the things my friends and I were putting ourselves in harm's way to do. And my mama, may she rest in peace, said you're either part of the problem or part of the solution. And so I decided to move back to my hometown of San Antonio and run for Congress. I lost that first election by 700 votes, which is not a lot of votes, by the way. I'm glad I don't have to tell that story anymore. But it gave me an opportunity to join a consulting firm and help build a cybersecurity company. What we did was we basically broke into banks, stole their money, and showed them how we did it. And we always got in, by the way. Like, seeing what the threat to our digital infrastructure from our adversaries is pretty shocking. And if you give me enough time, I'm going to get into your system. It was a great experience for me to learn and understand and see how technology was evolving and changing. But the opportunity came to run in 2014 again. When you get 700 votes close and you call all your homies and be like, hey, if you got one more in you, I got one more in you. And they say yes, and we took it. And so that time I won. I was in Congress for 3 years, three terms, 6 years. Now, I was the IT procurement guy. That is not a sexy topic. Nobody has ever held a parade for IT procurement. But one of the things I learned when I was in the government was spending $90 billion on purchasing IT goods and services, and 80% of that was on old, legacy, outdated stuff. Stuff that y'all would be like, come on, we're not gonna use that garbage. And when you explain to people that, hey, you're doing something about it, and that's when I learned and understood the importance of how we introduce technologies into the government, that's gonna impact constituents, that's gonna impact the community. Now, I held the first hearing on AI. I thought the hearing was gonna all be about, do y'all know what Whataburger is? We don't have Whataburger up here, do we? It's a burger chain that got started in Corpus Christi, Texas, but it's big in San Antonio. I thought we were going to be having a hearing about having a drone, you know, flying over my driverless car and drop my burger through the sunroof while I was trying to drive from San Antonio to El Paso. But we were talking about whether drones were going to peep into people's windows. And I'm like, we're not worrying about the FedEx guy peeping in your window. Why are we worrying about technology doing these things? But this was 2015, and people didn't understand what AI was. People didn't understand what autonomous vehicles were. But we started having those conversations. 2015 was the first time that it was talked about in Congress. My last piece of legislation was a national strategy for artificial intelligence. And what I've been able to do once I've left Congress, I've advised a number of some of the most cutting-edge AI companies. I've been on the board of OpenAI. Many of y'all probably know ChatGPT. Here's what's fascinating about ChatGPT. I know we're being recorded. I think this story is out there. We released it on November 30th. It's a very little fanfare because most of the engineers in the company thought it was okay because we were already working on the next iterations, right? And something that really changed the world and made people wake up to the powers of generative AI, to the people that were working on it, we thought it was just okay. What is generative AI? Look, all of y'all have used, prior to ChatGPT, all of y'all have used AI, right? You've bought something on Instagram that they showed you, right? Like that Instagram algorithm is legit, right? It's like every time it sends me something, I buy a lot of stuff off of Instagram. If you've used Google Maps, right, or Apple Maps, you've used some version of AI. But generative AI is a algorithm, a system, a piece of software that generates something new that didn't exist before. It's that simple. A large language model, which ChatGPT and Bard and the Claude is, I think, Anthropic's version, it's basically predicting the next word based on a whole lot of training. And to me, right now, this is, people are afraid of this because they're afraid it's going to change people's jobs or it's going to impact people's jobs. We should be afraid of this because artificial intelligence, and more specifically, artificial general intelligence, AGI. AGI is an algorithm that is smarter than most people on all economically viable work. That's going to be true intelligence. AGI is the equivalent, or has the power to be the equivalent of nuclear fission. How many of y'all are gonna watch Oppenheimer when it comes out tomorrow? Okay, how many are gonna go see Barbie instead? All right. Who's gonna see both of them? You know, I love movies. Nuclear fission controls. Gives you nuclear energy, clean, limitless energy. Nuclear fission uncontrolled gives you a weapon that can blow anything up. This is really how we should be thinking about artificial general intelligence. Now, the fears. 65% of Americans today believe a robot, an algorithm, AI, is going to take their jobs. Now, I was talking to a reporter on the way over here, and she asked me, is algorithm going to take her job? Well, if you write like you're in the eighth grade, then maybe it will take your job. Is it going to improve? Yes, but it's going to be a tool, right? But we need to be thoughtful about the impact this new tool is going to have on people's jobs. It's an influence tool that can be used by our adversaries and bad people. Imagine you have every bit of digital information about each one of you, and I could push you a message. I could push you multiple messages that is tied to you specifically over time. That's a powerful tool. And then people are worried about AI turning into the Terminator. Why does every movie about AI end up in some dystopian thing where a robot kills somebody? Now here's why people are afraid of this. It's called the alignment problem. You may have heard this when people talk about this. Alignment means, and here's what we have learned. The smarter the algorithm gets, the less likely it is to follow human intentions. Chew on that for a second. That's why the alignment problem is the biggest problem in artificial intelligence today, and figuring out how you harness this. Now, I'm of the school of thought that yes, we need to be mindful and understand all of these problems, just like every other technology has been an upside and a downside, but we have a real opportunity. AI can make us more efficient. For that reporter, it's going to be able to decrease your research by a significant amount of time. There's a few of us that have some white hairs that remember the Dewey Decimal System and the card catalog. Okay, raise your hand if you're under 30 and you know what the card catalog is and you've used it. Exactly. Okay, there you go. I got to hear that story. I got to ask you that question later. Look, this was an old school system. When I was in eighth grade and early high school, I had to go to the library, check out a book in order to write my papers. And guess what? I was screwed if somebody else had used that same book. And you're asking the librarian, hey, when is that book due? Don't let that person extend that, you know, having that book, because I need it. Right? Like, so it took forever to write a paper. Then the internet came. Now, at the beginning of the internet, teachers were saying, hey, you shouldn't be able to use the internet in order to do research. We're seeing some of the same pushback and same issues now with AI. It's a tool that can make us more efficient. It's also going to help us unlock knowledge that was previously undiscovered. Aspirin. We all know what aspirin is, right? You know that comes from the bark of a tree? Morphine. The most used pain medicine ever in the world. Comes from a flower, the poppy. We only understand and know 1% of the entire biological realm and how we can unlock that to actually solve problems and get medicines and help us live longer and happier lives. But guess what AI is helping us do? Actually understand how a protein molecule is made. Now, up until a couple of months ago, I was like, heck, I always thought all that chemistry I took, I thought we knew how every protein was made. We didn't know that. And now with AI, we have learned the structure of proteins, which allows us to figure out how we can manipulate that in order to find drugs and medicines in order to help us live a longer life. It's going to be a fraction of the time. We always talk about when it comes to healthcare, how expensive new drugs are, how expensive drug discovery is. This is going to be able to cut down our time to get something to market. And the last thing I'm going to say about AI is it has the ability to reduce income inequality. All of us that are here today, we're lucky. You're going to an awesome school. We have income inequality because we have education inequality. I was lucky to have a mom and a dad and a big brother and a big sister. My sister acted like my big brother, who would help me with my homework. Many of y'all probably had tools and people in your lives that helped you with your homework. What if you didn't have that? Where would you have been today? With AI, we can have a tutor in our pocket. Imagine a tutor that has unlimited patience, that always speaks to you kindly, doesn't get frustrated, and helps you learn at your speed. And then that information can be given to the teacher to understand and make the teacher more effective. Like, this is the opportunity that we have. But we're not going to be able to take advantage of these opportunities if we don't have people in office at all level that understand these technologies, that understand that regulation is needed in this case. Here's a simple one. It's got to follow the law. Rule one, AI's got to follow the law. It's that simple. Oftentimes with new technologies, we want to carve it out. Knowing what we know about social media today, would we have carved it out of the Communications and Decency Act 20 years ago. Knowing that social media is leading to teenage girls increasing cutting themselves, should we have made the same decisions back in the past? So let's not do that with artificial intelligence. It's got to follow law. We have a ton of laws about civil liberties and civil rights. You got to follow those things. Point two, if we wanted to go out and build a nuclear power plant or a parking lot, we would need some kind of certification. So any AI systems over a certain size or a certain power needs to have some certification. How are you looking at the alignment problem? We know that it's important to have a third-party person come in and validate some of your machine learning tools and machine learning algorithms so the algorithm is producing what it's supposed to do. We have an entity, NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology, that has the capabilities in order to do this. But guess what? If we're going to be able to do this kind of thing where we have a government entity that gives you some kind of certification for these really powerful tools, then we need smarter people in government. Right? We need where it's an 80% technologist, 20% bureaucrats. Now, I have some ideas on how to do this, something I've been trying to do ever since I was in Congress, but we need to make sure we have the talent to make sure these powerful tools are being developed the right way. Point three, government's got to use AI. We should be using it for customer service. We should be using it for digital-facing services. It should not take months to get up for a veteran to get an appointment at the VA. It should take minutes. It should not take months to get your passport renewed. We should be able to do that in minutes. A couple people are laughing, you know, because they know how crazy it is. We have the tools in order to do that. And guess what? If we start providing better services to our citizens, we're going to see an increase in trust in our government. And the last point, and I already touched it, every student gets an AI tutor. Whether you're learning calculus, farming, or plumbing, you should be able to have an AI tutor in your pocket in order to help us reduce that inequality I was talking about in our education system so that we don't have inequality in our income. We can solve all these problems. We actually got to talk about them. We actually need people that are willing to discuss this. We actually need people to have a competition of ideas, right, in order to make sure that we're taking advantage of technology before it takes advantage of us. And this is not about us achieving our best selves. We are in a competition. The Chinese government is trying to surpass us as a global superpower. And I'm very specific. I say the Chinese government. It's not the Chinese people. It's not Chinese culture. It's not Chinese Americans. You know, the amount of hate our Asian American brothers and sisters have seen since COVID is unacceptable, right? But we got to be clear-eyed about who our adversary is. It's the Chinese government. We know how the Chinese government are going to use these tools. They're going to use it to suppress their own people. They're going to use it to suppress thought. They're going to use it to suppress free speech. They're going to use it to suppress the Uyghurs. They're going to try to export this to other places. So it's us and our allies that need to be able to export this and our vision for these powerful tools to the rest of the world. So we can do this. And I will say that I'm glad and I get excited when I come to places like Dartmouth because y'all are the ones that are thinking about solving these problems. Y'all are the ones that care about our future. Y'all are the ones that are asking the questions. Y'all are the ones that are suspicious of everybody. What I love about Gen Z, y'all don't trust nobody, right? And that's very healthy. Keep that up. My parents' generation, if it was written, it must be true. My generation, Gen X, if it's on TV, that must be accurate, right? Y'all in Gen Z, you're suspicious of everyone. Keep that up because this is the kind of mentality that we need to make sure that we continue this competition of ideas that have made America the greatest country on the planet. Justin, I'll stop there and whatever questions you have. God bless you all.
Thank you very much. So as I said at the top, I'm going to ask some questions, and then we'll open it up to questions from you. And if you're out there watching on the stream, you can email questions to rockyqna@dartmouth.edu, and we'll try to get to those too. But I'm going to dig in because I want to make sure we use our time wisely. So thank you for those thoughtful remarks. I think there are inferences we could draw that will answer this question, but I'd rather ask you and hear your answer. Put simply, why do you want to be president?
We are faced with a number of generational defining challenges. The Chinese government trying to surpass us as a global superpower. AI is going to impact every industry, not in 10 years, but in 2 or 3 years. Our kids and grandkids schooling and scores on tests like math, science, and reading are at the lowest they've ever been in this century. These are questions and these are issues that are going to impact all of us, and we're not having enough conversation and discourse about how we solve these problems. I'm running in the Republican primary as well because I think the Republican Party has an opportunity to grow our brand, but that's going to require us to not be jerks, to not be homophobes, to not be misogynists or racist, and I'm not saying everybody is, obviously. There's more that are not, but this is the opportunity that we have to make sure that it's, you know, a conservative thought that moves the country forward.
So you mentioned, you know, the life of a presidential candidate is pretty hectic and unusual, and you mentioned that you were thirsty because you had French fries earlier, and my guess is you have a lot of French fries when you're on the campaign trail. You also mentioned an interesting a town hall you attended in Manchester. So how are the New Hampshire voters, who are historically quite critical and demanding, how are you finding them? How are they reacting to what it is that you're talking about?
I tell everybody back in Texas, you know, we always talk about Texans are nice. Folks in New Hampshire are really nice, right? Like genuinely, and what I appreciate, Granite Staters take their job as in first in the nation very seriously. A dark horse candidate like me has a chance because of a place like New Hampshire that is critical, that asks a lot of questions, that demands that you show up and engage and answer questions, right? And so I appreciate that about New Hampshire, and it's real. Like, you know, you read about this and you hear about this, but until you get here, it's serious. And so, look, I was up in the North Country. I think I'm the first candidate to do that. I think I'm the only one candidate to do that. I know Coos County only is going to have like 6,000 people vote, right? But the northern borders have started to see some of the same problems that we're seeing at the southern border. And it's responsible to have, you know, it's important to understand those issues. So I've enjoyed my time here. The only thing I need to find, I haven't found it yet. I haven't found a place to get a good breakfast taco. But I'm pretty particular being from San Antonio. So that's the only thing I'm missing in the last month.
In your remarks, if I remember correctly, you referred to your fellow congressmen as morons. Is that right?
That's about right. Yeah.
Yeah. So do you trust that these morons are going to be able to wrap their heads around AI and regulate it? I mean, you know, Sam Altman, the founder of ChatGPT, or at least one of the driving forces behind GPT, came before Congress and basically like begged Congress to regulate it before it got out of control. What do you think the prospects are for Congress enacting some sort of smart regulation, and what are the stakes?
So I should put an asterisk on this. There are some really good people, right? Had I met John Katko or Pete Aguilar when I was in the CIA, or Henry Cuellar or Peter Meyer, I wouldn't have left because these were quality people. In that hearing you're talking about, Josh Hawley and Earl Blumenthal. If you had a political continuum, these two are on the exact opposite ends. But it was really fascinating in that hearing that you're talking about, because you saw them being thoughtful and recognizing and understanding the need. I will say Congress has gotten it through their head that something needs to be done. The question becomes, what is the specific, right? And then how do you navigate all the interests? And that's why it's important to have people that understand this and can cut through all the noise and nonsense in order to move something. Now, the Europeans are 18 and 24 months ahead of us when it comes to legislation. There's a thing called GDPR. This was their privacy law. It was passed a couple of years ago. When you have all those pop-ups that say, you know, do you want to deal with these cookies? That was GDPR, basically. Mm-hmm. The U.S. doesn't have a privacy standard, which is important to deal with data, which is important to deal with AI. But the conversations are happening, and that's where if we had a chief executive that could direct some of these things, we can see some real positive change.
So you talked about it like a tutor in your pocket, which is already true. How do you think higher ed should think about AI? How should the faculty who are here think about it? Should they be concerned that their students are taking advantage of these tools, as you put it, to take a shortcut? And likewise, how should students think about how to use it but not abuse it? And overall, should we be scared at this moment or excited for the opportunity?
We should be excited and suspicious at the same time. It's a tool, so use it. Put bounds around it. Test it. So I used to, as an engineer at A&M, I used to always hate open book tests, because the questions would be really hard, right? They were going to be really hard. And so I think the grading of papers, the standards should be a lot higher than they are now. The sophistication of the questions that you're answering should be increased, because now you have the tool to synthesize a lot of information. So now the question becomes, what is the question that you're asking? What is the insight that you're delivering? Not whether you know these three facts about the war of 1812, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And so students should be using that to improve their efficiencies and the quality of their papers. But having something that's written exclusively by it, there's ways to test whether it's being written by AI or not. It's just like when the calculator was created, you know, it wasn't like, oh, you got to use your abacus, right? You can't use this new calculator thing. So we should be embracing it and explaining and testing how these tools should be used. Teachers and professors should be using this to help grade papers and get insights from what they're doing. So all of that can be used to make sure that the quality of education the students are getting is increasing. Hmm.
You mentioned going up to the northern border. Mm-hmm. Your district, when you were in Congress, was on the southern border. Yeah. And you've had some choice words for Joe Biden about being the worst border security president in our history. And that the fact that that he won't call it a crisis is shocking. Mm-hmm. So I'm curious, sort of, what should New Hampshire voters know about this crisis? Sure. Why should New Hampshire voters care? Is this an issue in the New Hampshire primary?
Sure. Before Joe Biden was the worst border security president, Donald Trump was, because mm-hmm. this crisis started under his leadership. And Granite Staters should care, because fentanyl is a problem, right? I think Granite Staters are just have a level of humanity about the rest of the world. When there's industries that don't have employees, right, having legal immigration could potentially be valuable. So what should we be doing about this? The problem started when Donald Trump started treating everybody coming across our border as an asylum seeker. Asylum is, anybody can claim asylum, it's legal. But asylum is very specific. You have to be part of a protected class. That means your race, sexual orientation, gender, ethnicity, and your government has to be targeting you because you're part of that protected class, or your government is not defending you because you're part of that protected class. Coming to the United States because you want a better job is not a reason for asylum. And so this change is what has led to 5.5 million people coming into our country in between our ports of entry, which is illegal, okay? Each person that's come in illegally has used a human smuggler. That's about $10,000 a person. That's about the average. So that's $55 billion in the last 3 years that has gone to human smugglers in Mexico and Latin America. The entire U.S. intelligence budget is $60 billion. This doesn't even include fentanyl, right? And so why should Granite Staters care? Because if we can't figure this out in the southern border, we're not going to be able to stop the growing problem at the northern border. And you're seeing an increase. Now, the numbers are nowhere near what you're seeing in the southern border, right? But you're starting to see a scary trend that needs to be stopped.
So if you want to get ready to ask some questions, I'm going to ask one more, and then we'll pivot to questions from you all. You mentioned, Congressman, your history in the CIA. I'm sure there's lots that I'd like for you to answer that you probably can't. But I'm curious how your experience in the CIA would inform your presidency. You know, should you get that far?
That first class I took in international studies when I was in college, the first lesson was rule of law. And I'm sitting there like 18-year-old Will Hurd's like, rule of law? Of course there's rule of law. What kind of dumb class is this, right? Talking about the rule of law? Like, we're gonna have a whole date on the rule of law? Please. You're laughing because you've probably been in that same class, right? But here's what I learned, living in some of these places I've lived. Not everybody has rule of law. We are lucky to live in the place where we live. I have seen our enemies up close and personal. We live in an incredibly complicated world. We live in an incredibly dangerous world that's only getting more complicated and more dangerous. We have, being connected to national security for the last 22 years, I have a simple formula. Your friends should love you, and your enemies should fear you. But that also requires to know who are your friends and who are your enemies. Guess what? Vladimir Putin is not our friend. I wish more people were focused on trying to stop Vladimir Putin than discriminating against some of my friends in the LGBTQ communities, right? And so those experiences in dealing with our adversaries impact me every single day. And here's the other thing I've learned. When you're in the CIA and you get an order from the president to be like, hey, this group's about to blow something up in America. You got to stop it. You don't get to say, sorry, boss. We don't have enough money. We don't have enough time. We don't have enough resources. The answer is, yes, boss, we'll go do it, right? Yeah. That attitude on how to solve a problem even when it seems intractable. Hmm. It was one of the greatest experiences and lessons that I was able to get. So yeah, like that experience, and this is why I get frustrated when there's an erosion of trust within our intelligence community, with our federal law enforcement. Yes, there are some people that are leaders of some of these organizations that have made some bad decisions, but the rank and file men and women are putting themselves in harm's way every single day and every single night in order to make sure we enjoy the liberties that we enjoy.
Thank you. So we got we got time for some questions. If you want to raise your hand and just wait until the microphone. I saw some hands go up over here first. And again, if you're online and you want to ask a question, rockyqna@dartmouth.edu.
Thank you for coming, Congressman.
What's your name and what are you studying?
My name is Josh. I'm 25. I'm studying government and Middle Eastern studies. Gotcha. I'm actually thinking of either going to the State Department or CIA after I graduate.
Do it, it's awesome.
Yeah, definitely. So one of the problems, I think you outlined three. I think the fourth one you got to mention is climate change. Mm-hmm. I'm a Republican. Republicans from Teddy Roosevelt, Nixon, Bush 41 sure. have a great history of addressing these environmental solutions. What are some market-oriented solutions sure. that you have to address climate change when you're president?
Yeah. Climate change is real, right? It's impacting us. And also, we have to make sure that we're allowing economic progress to happen. I think the number, somebody can fact check me, there's about 1 billion people that still don't have access to electricity. And that's pretty crazy when you think about it. So market issues. One, you know, any kind of debate about having clean, reliable, abundant energy has to include nuclear, right? And whether that's fission or fusion, the fact that we can even talk about fusion as something that's going to happen within, I think a decade is not a crazy prediction. That has to happen. I think in the short term, things like carbon capture, has the greatest impact to capture carbon at a price point that makes sense right now. Can it be a long-term solution? Not necessarily. But I also think there's going to be some technologies that we don't see. We also need to be helping other countries. That you don't have to go through the same cycle in your economy. We can help jumpstart that. So our foreign aid should be focused on that. And how do we make sure American companies are best when it comes to green energy? Look, I represented the Eagle Ford Shale and the Permian Basin. The reason America is energy independent is because of the Eagle Ford Shale and the Permian Basin. And so we can make sure that we have an all-the-above energy strategy to address the long-term needs of our planet. Mm-hmm. And thank you for, look, here's the other thing. It's like not too many Republicans will probably say what I just said, right? Like, don't be afraid of it. And so, the reality is, when it comes to folks, one of the reasons that Republicans do so poorly with folks under the age of 35 is because we're afraid of having a real conversation about protecting our planet. Sir, okay.
We got two right here.
Yep. Hey, sir, on behalf of the Upper Valley Republicans, Jim Rubin's here. Yeah. Thank you for coming to the northern part of New Hampshire and to Hanover. So
everybody in Pittsburgh, I don't know if they'd call this the northern part of New Hampshire.
You're right. You're exactly right. Pittsburgh is the real North Country, right? Yeah, yeah. So you've been there, yeah?
Yeah, I have.
All right.
I have.
So over the past 30 years, the U.S. Supreme Court has struck down almost every regulation with respect to campaign money. And so over the last two U.S. Senate election cycles here in New Hampshire, about 95% of the campaign money has come from out of state, from D.C. party bosses, from kingmaker super PACs, and typically from California, New York. And what's happened is those folks don't know about New Hampshire issues. They don't really care very much about them. They don't care very much about New Hampshire voters, and they're not hearing New Hampshire voices. So, and then we also have, as a result of this open season on the money flood, we have dark money coming in from China and Russian, from four enemies mm-hmm. are actually in our elections. So the question is, what would you be willing to back a constitutional amendment that an organization I'm affiliated with sure. proposes to allow states to set limits on this money as they see fit, and Congress the right to set limits on this campaign money as they see fit?
Sure. As someone who has had $70 million of negative advertising dropped on my head in a congressional seat, right, that's crazy. When my general consultant makes more money than my chief of staff, the two entities that benefit from money in politics is what I call the professional political class and the TV stations, right? And so look, I think that is something that has hurt our politics. What specifically we can be doing and what y'all are talking about, giving the states power, I am definitely open to seeing how we make this better, right, than what it is now. And look, this is from somebody who, you know, I didn't come from money. I've had to be able to raise money, right? And I can only raise it $3,300 at a time. All that stuff is on a website that you can evaluate and look through. And having that as the gold standard is something that I'm open to.
Let's hear from some students. We got here.
And we got one guy over here, too.
Yeah, and then we'll come over here.
Hi there. I'm Mac. I study history and math here.
Right on.
You talked about artificial intelligence playing a role in education and the ability for something like a personal tutor to help kids get more of an equal opportunity for education. But I see kind of artificial intelligence and technology like that maybe being more of a crutch for our education system than a true solution. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about Sure. your vision for improving equal access to education.
Sure. Look, it starts with we have income inequality because we have education inequality, plain and simple. And there's also a digital divide that comes into this. When we start having, need to have access to more tools, that means people got to have access to the tool. Then you got to have access to the infrastructure. Then you got to have access to the know-how on how to leverage all those things, right? And so, but that problem shouldn't prevent us from using this as a tool to further our advancements, right? Like, do you know how to write in cursive?
No.
Okay, so is that a good or a bad thing, right? And so some of these fundamental skill sets we should know, right? Like, I actually think some people say, we don't need our kids knowing programming anymore because you're going to be in a completely no-code environment. Well, understanding how that works matters. Being exposed to coding in a middle school is something we should have. I think our people in high school should be able to have access to advanced statistics and machine learning, right? And so we should be thinking through what are those skill sets that are necessary for not just the economy as it is today, but as the economy is going to exist when it comes for your time to get out. So any tool can potentially become a crutch, right? But the fact that it could potentially become a crutch means doesn't mean you shouldn't explore it.
Mm-hmm. Hi, thanks for being here. You talked a lot about AI and also China's quest to take us over as a global superpower. One thing that I thought notably was missing from your speech was any discussion of quantum computing and quantum technologies and the global arms race for that.
You're speaking my language, brother. Thanks for bringing it up. Yeah.
So a lot of experts would say that we are already second best to China in that arms race, mm-hmm. and China just announced a $16 billion investment in quantum technologies, and the U.S. only invested around $2 billion.
Sure.
Would you dramatically increase the money we invest as a country in quantum technologies?
Yes, and I would also improve the collaboration between our national labs, entities within the federal government, the executive branch, and those in the private sector that are working on this. Right. Again, I hope that the Oppenheimer movie is going to have more people understand what does the Manhattan Project actually mean, and that level of coordination, and actually solve big problems. But yes, quantum computing is a significant issue, just like I didn't talk about synthetic biology. Right, quantum computing, for those that here's what you need to know. In traditional computing, a bit can be a one or a zero, on or off. But in quantum, it can be one, zero, both, or neither, all at the same time. Like, that's really like a philosophical question. I used to always say it's a Schrodinger's cat question, but like my wife told me to stop saying that because it's not funny and nobody knows what it is, but you probably know what Schrodinger's cat is. All you need to know is that gives you unbelievable power. And then there's another trend in quantum computing where two items can be entangled even when they're far apart, right? Like it's just wild. And so quantum computing, those two principles are gonna allow us to have a computer that can break all the kind of encryption that we know today, right? So your phones, stock market, email, you name it. Y'all are too young. There's a few of us in here that remembers Y2K. My man back there remembers Y2K, right? So I'm in college, and I'm like, I don't want to be on the road on Y2K. I was in San Antonio. My girlfriend was in Dallas. I was like, babe, I can't come because I don't want to be on the road when the zombie apocalypse happens, right? Y2K, basically, it was a non-entity because the U.S. government spent $4 billion over 3 years changing in all of our software the year to go from two-digit to four-digit, right? $4 billion. Getting a quantum resilient encryption is going to be much more significantly harder than that. And we got to start moving to that now before this happens, right? So you're absolutely right. I would still say most of these things that talk about the Chinese government being ahead of the US is only on published research that's happened. There's a lot of stuff that isn't, but I would say we're still good for a tie. And the third area, and I'll wrap this up, I know we got some more questions, synthetic biology. Today, we can program DNA like computer code. What? Right? Should we be able to make sure that some child doesn't have clubfoot? Most people say, okay, yeah. Should we allow a child to be 7 feet tall and have hands twice my size? Most people probably be like, maybe not. But you know who's not gonna probably have those kinds of questions and thought through those issues? Our competitors and our adversaries, right? So there are a number of technologies. Hypersonics is another one to talk about, right? So these are the technological change we're gonna see in the next 30 years is gonna make the last 30 years look like we were monkeys playing in the dirt with sticks, right? And that's exciting and scary. And for y'all, if y'all, I don't care what your major is, y'all need to have a physics class or something like this, because all these things are gonna impact all of y'all.
I'm gonna take one question from our viewers at home, and then I wanna give you an opportunity to wrap it up.
Sure.
So this comes from a viewer. What is your point of view on executive orders? What crisis might you deem urgent enough to utilize an executive order were you president?
Look, the reason you have an increase in use of executive orders is because the chief executive's not being able to work with Congress in the right way, right? All the pieces of legislation that we remember, the Civil Rights Act, the ADA, the Clean Water Act, all these major pieces of legislation were actually passed in a very bipartisan way. The only way to get big things done is when we do it together, right? And so that's always the initiative. Like we are better together, and when we realize that, we're gonna be able to do more than trying to move on executive action, right? And so reducing the size and scope of the federal government, I think, is important. I think pushing power back down to the lowest level possible is something important. So that's kind of my philosophy on executive power. And I'll end with a story when I was in the CIA. 2007, I was in Pakistan, and there was an earthquake in a town called Muzaffarabad that ended up killing 90,000 people. The ambassador at the time, this was so destructive to the country that the government didn't know what to do. And our ambassador wanted to show that, hey, the United States of America is gonna be helping the Pakistani people. So he said, Hurd, get up there, figure out what they need. So I took a team, we get to this place, and we realized they needed airlift. This was Muzaffarabad is at about 14,000 feet, and there were a number of other villages higher up cut off from the rest of the community, and they needed airlift to move this. And so our ambassador got us 22 Chinook helicopters. These are big old monsters. And I'm sitting there directing this airlift. And I'd been on the ground for 4 days, and I had to go back to the capital, Islamabad, to give a report to the ambassador. And we had a piece of information that suggested this one town had been without food, water, power for 4 days. And this was middle of winter, negative 20 degrees below zero at night. So we said, hey, let's go to this village, pick them all up, and we'll take them to the Capitol. So we land this big helicopter, big bay doors come off, and if you've ever seen a helicopter crew, they look like they're from outer space, right? You know, slick jackets, black mask, hoses. And all these villagers start piling on, about 200. And this village elder had this little girl who was 6 or 7 years old. She had lost her mother and her father in this earthquake. And this village elder, she sees this scene, she thinks everybody's from outer space, she's screaming, she's crying, and this village elder hands this little girl to me. And I'm holding on to her as tight as I can. We take off, and about halfway through the trip, she relaxes, rests her head on my shoulder. And we get to the destination, and I put the little girl down, and she takes about 10 steps and spins around and comes back and gives me the biggest hug I've ever gotten in my life. She goes over to the helicopter crewman and kisses him on the hand, and he pats her on the head and gives her a thumbs up and smiles real big. And the little girl returns the gesture and runs away, right? And that girl's face is seared into my brain, because on that day, the United States of America was the only country that has the resources and the willingness to help people even if they were 6,000 miles away. And the reason we also showed that day of why the United States of America has become an exceptional nation. We are an exceptional nation not because of what we have taken, but because of what we have given. And when we remember that principle, we're gonna make sure the rest of this century stays the American century, and that's why I'm trying to run for president.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I know you got a big night tonight with
some
students.
That's right.
Yeah, it'll be fun.
Thank you all.
Yeah, thank you.